You're listening to Paint the Town podcast with your hosts. LA Street Art Gallery resident artist, Teachr, and founder of LA Street Art Gallery, James Chen of
What's up, brother?
Good to see you, man.
I know, right? Good to actually see people other than who's in your house.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, today we got a good guest coming on, and he's going to be calling later on at any moment. Professor Jim, man.
I love Jim, man. I can't wait to have the little, we got a little recap from his show. At
the apocalypse happened, man.
The Oceanside Museum of Art.
That was all before, when times were such simpler, you know what I mean?
Think back to how crowded it was there, you know?
I know, I mean, if we could have been passing around the coronavirus, man, you know, this is, you know, during that time.
Let's see.
You don't take it so seriously at that point, you know what I mean?
I guess technically we could have been. It could have been there, really.
To be honest, who knows, you know? I mean, how are you feeling about it lately? You know, anxiety kicking off? I mean, you spending time with the kids or?
Dude, we're finally, there's still some struggles just because the schoolwork that we get on a daily basis that the kids have to be there for and have to accomplish is substantial. I mean, it's a lot. Plus they have the Zoom classrooms where they actually have to sit there and be present, and they get in trouble if they're not there.
I actually heard this thing about the Zoom, the hackers, right? Did you hear about that?
No. Well, what now?
I'll tell you the good story.
What are they hacking now, man?
I'll tell you the good story first, okay? Peyton Manning, first of all, he kind of like joined a random class from his alma mater.
Yes, I heard that.
Right? So, you know, that's kind of like a nice surprise, right? So, you know, but then, of course, I just read in my local, groups and stuff like that. There's a sixth grade classroom in Yorba Linda, and they're having their Zoom, classroom meeting, right? And all of a sudden, somebody hacks in and starts showing gay porn on the screen.
Oh, wow.
I'm just saying that's really damaging. You know what?
That's a new form of graffiti. You know, it's cyber graffiti.
I mean, that's really damaging to the kids. But I mean, like, I was just like, oh man, dude. You know what? The whole world has been dealing with coronavirus, right? And then leave it to America for that to first happen. you know what I mean? It's like, you gotta. You gotta hand
of course,
it to America, man. Of course, you know what I mean. It's
probably some guy in Florida.
It's a new low. You know. I just thought that's kind of interesting. Like I said, there's different sides of the spectrum. You know, there's Peyton Manning, like, you know, surprising a class. I think it's like really wonderful. And there's the dudes who are gonna show gay porn in a classroom. You know what I mean?
So, like I said, it's probably some guy in Florida. You know.
Well, I mean, yeah, man. I always hear these Florida stories, man, and you know, I feel like, you know,
there's a reason why I left. And
yeah, the Redneck Riviera, man. I mean, like, you always
where I'm from, the area that I am from is called the Redneck Riviera. It's the Panhandle. It's Lower Alabama.
People out there are they taking it seriously? I mean, like, you talk to your dad, right? I mean, is he taking it? He's probably living an isolated life anyways, right?
Yeah, like I said before, dad's loving it. He's a hermit. That's where I get my ability to be a hermit myself is from my dad. That dude, you know, he accidentally FaceTimed me the other day. But, you know, now I know that it'll actually works on his phone. So now I can FaceTime him, and it's awesome. He loves being able to see me and actually see the kids and stuff.
So he finally learned it during this time of coronavirus, I mean, and has nothing to do with the coronavirus, basically.
Hey, you know what? Necessity is the mother of invention, right? But, no, he's got neighbors on both sides of him. that are know to include them in anything they can. They, you know, they check up on them now. This for him is really nice. He loves watching TV and going on his walks. That's and going to church. Goes to church on Sunday, goes to McDonald's afterwards, and so, you know, just no church on Sunday. But he's got TV shows that he watches to take care of the church. So
they shut down his church yet?
Yeah. Yes, they did.
Yeah, I heard.
Well, it was because there was some. There was some adultery going on with the minister, and the local cardinal had to get him out of there.
Oh, so it doesn't have anything to do with the coronavirus right now?
No. The fact that his church is shut down, they had to sell the place because they built too much. They just kept adding on and another building. And you know what? I don't want to say any bad thing about them. You know what?
I was just saying they're shutting
down. They got what they had coming to them. You know what I mean? It's when you're running a church and, you know, and you keep building out and building out and building out, at some point it's not good. Oh, I see. Yes! Here we are!
What's up? Love it.
Hey, Jim. How's it going? Professor, how's it going?
Professor Jim, how's it going, brother?
I'm doing great.
It's so good to see you, man.
Good to see you, too. Are you guys holding up okay?
Yeah. You know, I was saying to Teachr in the last few episodes, a lot of artists, I mean, their lives are kind of unchanged. I mean, you know, they're sitting at home. They don't have a lot of social events to go to except for their own shows, maybe. And then they're used to being a hermit a lot of time in the year, you know what I mean?
That is so true. It's just the sales stuff is down and
people are
exposed to the work. But you're right. Studio work doesn't change. It's an introvert's life.
Yeah, it's staying at home and being hungry. So,
well, I had an artist residence going on at MRG Gallery in Sherman Oaks, and that was going to go on for another couple of weeks, but we decided to, you know, we actually called it off like a few days before everything got shut down, anyway, and you know, just going to wait till everything clears back up and then get back to it, but. You know, other than that, the homeschooling has been humbling with the twins. Yeah, you know, what's it like at your house, Jim?
Well, the oldest was studying in Italy for study abroad. She's a sophomore in college, and she was in Milan, the epicenter of all of it. And that was back when we thought it was just like the flu, right? And people weren't taking it so seriously. So she was there, her school closed down. And I was scheduled to go out and visit her at that time. And so rather than go to Milan, I went to Barcelona and we met there. And then Trump decided to want to close all the borders while we were asleep. So we were woke up at like 4 a.m. in the morning with everyone saying Trump's on TV saying he's going to close all the borders like by Friday.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. So we were on a plane.
Buy a ticket back immediately.
We went to the UK the next morning, and we were there for 2 days, and that's when our plane was supposed to leave from London. And then they closed the borders with the UK like that Monday. But the homeschool, the younger two are, it's going fine. They're a little bit older, the middle school and high school, so they're handling it well.
How was the airport when you got back? Was it a chaos or was it a ghost town?
It surprisingly wasn't that bad in LAX. We waited for basically maybe a half hour.
Okay,
and there wasn't any extra screening or anything like that. The problem was when we were leaving London, the folks at the gate were asking, and the people just work at the airline, were asking where we traveled, asking if we'd been in any of these other countries. Meanwhile, they're flipping through our passports, like trying to catch us. And, you know, the right answer is, no, I haven't been anywhere. So, you know, they don't have the right to ask that, so they let you through. But they did pull people aside where they wouldn't let them on the plane if they had been in certain countries.
Wow. So what are they going to do to them? It seems just quarantine them or something like that.
Yeah, just ask them, you know, I don't know what the deal was other than that, you know, sorry.
This way, we got some nice little bracelets for you. We'd like to, a gift for you to, we'd like for you to put them on now if you don't mind. And
yeah, exactly.
Seriously. Come this way with us. This way. Here, put this little mask. There you go.
And sit here. Just sit here. How long? No, don't ask questions. It definitely was weird. It felt like you couldn't believe this type of thing was happening.
Yeah, I mean, I think
your first pandemic, huh, Jim?
Yeah, first one for me.
Yeah, I was just getting back from Brazil too at that time, right before, and it seemed like it was pretty. There you go. We dropped for a second. We kind of switched positions. Getting back from Brazil for a second, and it's LAX seemed like pretty normal. They just asked me a couple questions too, and we're all managing. So, but you know what? Let's not just make our focus about the coronavirus this whole episode, man. There's a few things I wanted to, you know.
We want to recap about what you had going on at the Oceanside Museum of Art, my friend.
And that. I want to hear about Barcelona too, because you took some amazing pictures. And you know, as a art professor, I feel like, you know, we should definitely take some notes down right here from some of your insights. But yeah, let's talk about the Oceanside Museum first, man. That was an amazing show, man. And man, I think that was like the most popping thing going on in Oceanside that day, man, because there were so many people there. And you know, by the time we left, there were still new people coming in, man. I'm like, is this a nightclub or an art show, man? You know, because they were turning people away too. I loved it. It was very exclusive. You know, if you didn't sign up for it, you got to come back and take a look later too. So, you know, we just want to thank you for letting us have the opportunity, Jim, to do the podcast on site, man.
Oh, I was so glad you guys were there. It was super fun. That was like what openings were meant to be, is a celebration, it's a party, showcasing artists and just getting people excited about something. I love it. It was lying around the block, which is crazy. It's like waiting to get into Oceanside Museum of Art. I mean, it made me so happy, and it felt like you're contributing towards the local culture and, you know, my new neighborhood, and it was a super blast. New friends.
We got there early. We got there early, and just because one of my biggest pet peeves is to have to drive somewhere in LA and make it there just in time. So I made sure I got there very early, and so, you know, we were there before anyone even started showing up, right? And so just because some of the shows that I had been to previously had not seen that many people show up, mm-hmm. I was not prepared for the intensity and the amount of people that showed up. It was so, so amazing how packed that place got. I was very, very, very impressed. You know, it's a small town. It's Oceanside, you know. And what would you say Oceanside is like? You know, the community of Oceanside, the people there.
Yeah, Oceanside, it's interesting. It's this, it's almost like this forgotten beach town, because it has this military presence, a bit of a blue collar presence. It's probably the forgotten, you know, city in all of North County and San Diego, because it's so far away from, you know, San Diego Central. So it's a little lost up there. But I always think it's a gem. It's in a way, it's a land that time forgot, because there's so many older businesses and mom and pop type shops. And the city centers is amazing. Like all those government buildings are all just located in one central place. And the museum is stuck there right in the middle. So it's a beautiful little design. And I think it's one of those gems, special gems. And there's nothing like it in North County. There's not another museum like that in Northern San Diego. And because it's like, it's basically almost equidistant from, you know, maybe Southern LA County and downtown San Diego. So it serves a pretty nice population if you get the shows right.
Well, you got the show right, my friend. You had like some big hitters. I mean, first of all, my favorite, Robbie Conal. it was funny because we were able to get him over for a few minutes for an interview. And I'm usually really good about not fanboying about anybody, dude. I've met everybody. I've met 4-star generals, you know, whatever. And have kept my shit together. I lost my shit with Robbie Conal, man. He called, at one point he called himself Papa Smurf. And I was just like, James ended up having to ask the questions. You know what I mean? I was just like going, Robbie Conal. Smurf, man.
To me, it was so cool because the demographic of normally what you would consider, some people in the art community may consider street art like lowbrow or something like that, you know? But the demographic of Oceanside definitely is not someplace you would expect that it would be a show that would be thriving to that point, basically, you know? So I really thought it broke some barriers in Southern California, you know? It was really like a historic moment for street art, at least in Southern California, I feel, you know, because it's really opening it up to a broader demographic, in my opinion.
Yeah, I got the very conservative feel when I, you know, like I said, I was there early, so I took like a little, you know, drive just around the area, grabbed something to eat, and, you know, very clean and neat and pristine, and, you know, wouldn't surprise me if it was Republican and just, you know, very conservative. So that was one of the reasons why I was like, man, I hope people show up for Jim, man. I love this guy and everything, but God, this place looks conservative, man. He's got this sidewalk art activism going in here, man. I don't know. Woo! Are they going to show up? But man, boy, did they ever, dude.
And like that I said, awesome. The art, it just looked like it belonged in there in a museum, including yours, Teach. You know, it was so well curated, man. So big ups to you, Jim, and props, man. It was just a wonderful experience. And, you know, I'm really happy that we can even just be on site, because I felt like, there's people trying to get in and, you know, they can't even get in. Yeah, you know, so I felt.
I got a question for you, just so people have an idea. When did you start preparing for that show?
Roughly about 2 years ago. So it was a long time. And, you know, the early parts of a museum show are more political and trying to introduce.
I can't even imagine.
Yeah, you know, and making sure that there's trust. Obviously, I'm an unknown to them, or, you know, we don't have personal relationships. So it's a little bit like dating, to make sure that personalities will work. They don't want to invite somebody that's going to run amok, can't handle a budget. Someone who's going to follow through with plans, et cetera. Plus, you're introducing a whole new group of artists that they're not familiar with. And so they really want trust with the curator that if things go wrong, you know, can they trust the person to come alongside and understand how an institution works? So I tried to ease all their fears as being a dean and a professor and working in several museums along the way, that I want to make a great show for them. And, you know, it's not a good show for the artist, but it's not a great show for the museum as well.
What was their response? How did the museum feel?
We took a liking to each other instantly. I think I said the right things. I think working in museums, I understand the pressure that they're under all the time, the budgets, how tight they are, and how they don't really want people coming and telling them their business, because they know their business better than anybody else.
And you know, so, the right things to say.
Yeah. And I said, I understand that. And I said, trust me, I will be the easiest curator you've ever worked with. And there were bumps along the way. And with anything in life, you handle them together. And you try to decrease the stress in the room and help people through it. So, you know, it's
was not, there ever, was there ever a moment where you felt like, you know what, this might not work?
There were a few moments when we were installing, and the museum and some of the folks actually saw the artwork and realized how political it was. Like, you know, all of a sudden it becomes real. That, you know, at first it's like, wow, this is gonna be so cool. All these people have followings, it's gonna be edgy. And then it comes in, you're like, oh my gosh, it's really edgy. What do we do? And it's like, all right, you know, it's like, we knew what we were getting into, but it's going to be worth it. I promise you it's going to be worth it. It's those sort of conversations. And, you know, trust me, we're going to be okay. And then when opening night happened, everyone knew it was okay, because they hadn't seen crowds like that. The docents basically were saying, I've never seen crowds this big before at the museum.
So, Jim, I mean, were those all your friends that you just called up?
I have 5 friends. I'm a professor.
I'm about the same, my friend. I've got about this many actual people that I can really call true friends. You know what I mean? A lot of people that I love and love to be there for and everything, do whatever I can for. But yeah, dude, when it comes to actual friends, woo.
That's the power of group shows, though, right? It's everyone's collective networks and all the artists involved.
Well, but Jim, also, just so people know, how many books is it you have now that involve street art?
How many folks are involved in street art?
No, how many books have you done now that have street art involved?
I think 5 or 6, something like that.
Okay. So this is another reason why this guy right here was able to pull some of the big people that he was able to pull is, you know, when you've written that many books about street art, people recognize the effort that he's putting behind it. And, you know, it's like, that's where you get the respect.
That's why Jim's one of our, you know, the recurring guests on our show, you know what I mean? The show's grown quite a bit. I mean, it doesn't seem
like. Dude, now that we can do this,
quarantine.
Now that the Zoom, you know what? I don't mind plugging Zoom, dude. I mean, they were struggling for a while, like, I don't know how long, and then all of a sudden, like, they're an overnight success. But just to be able to do this is you know, awesome. What are you doing? Oh, you're doing your fancy stuff now, huh?
Yeah, so basically, I'm just saying, like, we can actually, if you guys end up having a deep art conversation about an artist, I can actually, you know, pull it up and talk to you guys, you know, and so we have an immediate visual reference, so it's just something cool that, you know, we're able to do, so just going back to recap, like, we had Snyder on the show inside, at the Oceanside, this is at the Oceanside Museum of Art right there, too. And we, you know, talked about some good old times, a beef with Lister. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were able to have a few other artists right on the spot. We had, you know, Plastic Jesus. We had Sketchy. We had OG Mike Giant and also Robbie Conal when Teachr fanboyed out, you know.
Yeah, okay, yes, okay. You mentioned that. I pressed up to it.
I listened to those almost right afterwards. It was really, it was nice to hear the hum of the crowd in the background. You guys did a great job with those interviews.
Thank you so much.
Dude, and that was all to this guy right here. I mean, all the setup that we brought with us and everything.
Shout out to her too, because she was a producer that day. But, you know, this is the thing, Jim. I mean, we really just enjoy doing events, you know, and then we'd love to work with you more, man, because especially, like, you know, we don't have any credibility like you do, you know? So you know, we kind of just, like I said, it was amazing to be able to talk to Robbie Conal. I mean, I could imagine some of the guests at the party when they were looking at how political some of the the pieces were, you know, especially his, right? So I don't know. I just thought it was such a wonderful night, you know, and I had such good times. Thank you again.
Yeah, of course. Like I said, I appreciate you guys being there. And the best part is hearing all the reactions as people look at the work. And it's always surprising who reacts to what. I did a tour with all the docents that do, they did the tours for the months afterwards. And they tend to be a lot of senior citizens. And they loved Robbie's work because they recognized all the political figures from all these decades. Mm. And they were cracking up. They thought it was absolutely hilarious. And which is the right response. It's using humor to lower any sort of like guard you have to engage with some other view that, you know, all of a sudden you can start thinking about. So it was great.
Yeah, I love Thomas Smurf, man. He's you know, taking the next level, man. So, yeah. But let me ask you, how many of these people that come up to you when you start talking about street art, and do they say like Banksy? Is that their first thing that they always say to you? Just curious, because I hear that all the time, you know.
Yeah.
And I just nod my head and said yes, like Banksy.
Yeah. I mean, it's usually is Banksy, or it's some obscure person that they followed. You know, they saw someone do work on a sidewalk sometime.
Yeah. Like Teachr, maybe.
Yeah. Or they, you know, the guy who has the buckets and he spray paints globes around them, or, you know, solar system or something in Santa Monica.
Oh, okay.
But it's usually Banksy. And there's nothing wrong with that. I've gotten used to sort of at every sort of level of aesthetic development and how folks engage. And it's something I try to get my students to understand, is that most of the folks you engage with in the world are going to be a level one or level two sort of at aesthetic development, which means they're going to be emotionally connected to work of art, and they want to relate it to some sort of story, or they want to relate the work of art to some other sort of level of success in their own life. Like, it takes hard work to make something, or it takes a lot of time to do something, or if it's realistic, or if it's very realistic, that's how they judge quality. And so Banksy fits perfectly. Actually, a lot of street art does too, because it's so realistic and you get it right away, which is one of the reasons I like it, because it gets those sort of intro folks, the newbies at looking at art, interested, and you can take them further. So if someone knows Banksy, great. That means they've looked at art and you can take them someplace else.
Awesome. Now let me ask you now. So on the curve, I don't know how many exponential curve graphs I've been looking at the past few days. Maybe that's like why my mind is in this mode, basically. But on the curve of how popular street art has been, let's just say, starting from the Robbie Conal days, how on a scale of 1 to 10, how popular do you think it is in social, culture right now?
Yeah, it feels very popular. It certainly had a peak in culture a few years ago. I mean, when there were so many big museum shows, so many publications, there was a TV show, right? And there were so many folks practicing it. So I definitely feel like it's ticked down since then.
Mm-hmm. That was maybe around 2010 or something, basically.
Yeah, I feel like that was like the heyday where there were probably more street artists working than any other time in history. But it also has still continued to be a very relevant subculture genre. I would call it a genre of art, especially since there's the auction houses have a genre for it, calling it urban art. So it's definitely ticked up since the late 70s when the term street art was crystallized. And it's while it's kind of gone up and down, I would say it went up in the 80s, and I think it ticked down a little bit in the 90s, and then in the 2000s, it slowly ticked up until you get to that 2010 peak, I think, and it's come down a little bit. So that's how I think of it.
That reminds me, I met a guy at the opening at the Oceanside Museum of Art, and it was one of the most interesting comments of the whole visit that I had there, people I met that I didn't know. Just a random guy that I started talking to, very conservative fella. And he said that, he was there actually supporting his wife. And he said, each civilization is going to be judged based on the art that they produce. And I was like, wow, that's interesting, man. Yeah. So when you're talking about how, street art, when it started coming about and everything, and then it had its peaks and everything, what does that say about a civilization when that type of genre is having its peak or its valley?
Yeah. I like to think that it's a culture. I think we're a culture that's hungry for art, and we're hungry for visual imagery. We want to make meaning out of things, and we're frustrated with the gallery and museum folks that have basically run things for most of the 20th century. Art has become a very elitist tool. It's something that a certain culture seems to command and play with, almost like a commodity in some cases. And so street art, I love calling it the art of the people because it meets us where we are every day, and you don't need any of those walls or barriers or institutions or people to get to it. And it's free for all. You don't need a book. You don't need to read anything by me. You don't need
a certain time of day.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what's great about it. I mean, it's accessible. It's not obtuse. It's not minimalism. It's not highly conceptual. It can be, but often it's not. And so I think that says something about where we are in history and why we're attracted to that kind of art. I think we're kind of tired of the highfalutin art world.
I gotta tell you, I think that it's interesting with the pandemic coming around now. I feel like it's going to change some things. Already, one of my galleries, one of the top galleries in LA, the Bruce Lurie Gallery, has shut down.
Wow.
And I'm sure there's going to be plenty of others that are going to follow. Mm-hmm. Now, when it comes to museums and bigger galleries, you got to figure at some point, they're gonna have to take, something's gonna happen. Something's gonna be a little bit different, like the spacing and everything.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of a long-term effect? I feel like this is gonna maybe help give another rise to art done in the streets and public art.
Yeah,
graffiti has certainly. I've been seeing. I mean, just driving along the 10, just down. I've been seeing a lot of throwies and a lot of crazy graffiti going up because I think there's just less people out right now, and these guys mm-hmm. can really take their time.
And yeah.
Stuff.
Interesting. That's amazing. But people need to be heard, right? You know, you're locked up inside. It's the same sort of thing, like the rise of sort of these voices with the original graffiti writers sort of in Philadelphia and New York in the early 20th century. It's, these are people that wanted a voice, you know, they felt like they weren't being heard. And I can see something similar happening, right? We're all locked up and so to speak, and it seems like we're only hearing a few voices nowadays, you know, whether it's Donald Trump every morning or whoever's on the, in the media. And it's, you know, your local governor or mayor or whatever. And so I can see artists taking control of that. I was watching Contagion the other day and Robbie Conal was in it. They had a...
Contagion, what's that?
That's the movie where the virus, it's a virus movie, right? It starts with a bat dropping a banana and a pig eats it and Matt Damon's in it and his wife dies within 3 or 4 days, et cetera.
God, I don't need to be watching shit like that.
Yeah, yeah. So, but basically all the society's like dying, everyone's locked up, everyone's staying home, they're rationing everything, and they show all the street art. And Robbie Conal did a bunch of posters for the movie. And so it's really interesting how art mirrors life, right? And will we see something like that if we get to a point and when we see artists rise up and feel like, hey, we need to hear alternative voices from the things that we're hearing every day?
Yeah, I've had some pieces come out of me, you know, having to do with, you know, the pandemic. I did the TP guy, I call him, you know, with the toilet paper and the jacket. The turtle with the Capitol building on its back.
Yeah.
And then actually just made these little guys, calling them pandemic pups. See these little guys?
Yeah, I saw those online. That's great.
Jim, are these the Robbie Conal posters for Contagion, basically?
Yep, those are them.
Awesome, awesome. See, look at that, technology.
Just like that.
Just like that.
It looks like a lot like the Reagan poster he did in the 80s that said a contradiction. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah,
that's what are you doing watching Contagion during this time? Are you trying to scare your kids or what's going on?
I think my wife and I have watched every sort of virus epidemic movie recently. I don't know. I count it as research.
Yeah, yeah. That's not a bad thing right there.
Yeah.
I want to begin with all the hit. You know, this is the thing these days, you know, because like air fingers are back.
That's right.
You know, I feel like Jim right now, he's Professor Jim right now, you know, away in some shelter, especially if I look at the camera right now, you know, he's in some underground shelter with his family, just, you know, dodging the virus, watching virus movies.
Yeah. Yeah, and we got 2 years of toilet paper here. We're good.
Good. Good. That's a hot commodity in some places. You know?
It's crazy how people are reacting, huh? Dude,
we think that's the weirdest thing. I can't believe people.
I was actually reading about it and they said that it is actually, they did a study or I don't know, some people did some studies and they said it is actually a form of retail therapy to the max actually, because you're buying something to comfort yourself, but you really, we're such soft people. We have no idea what to do during the apocalypse. So we basically just get toilet paper. Yeah,
exactly.
So I thought that was a pretty interesting point of view on it, you know, but hey, I wanted to actually ask you about Barcelona too, because I mean, come on, it's such a architecturally beautiful city, you know. I've been
there. A lot of Gaudi.
Yeah, and you know, Teachr, you've been there before, right?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you know, so all three of us have been there before, man. And what's your point of view on Barcelona? Just curious, as a professor.
Absolutely loved it. So I read Gaudi's biography when I was there. And then made it a point basically to jog around the entire city. And so I was able to visit the park city designed, all the various apartments, and of course, you know, his chapel, which is incredible. I've never seen the inside of a chapel that's so glorious and beautiful and looks like it was growing from the inside as though it was reaching up towards the heavens and pushing the roof higher and higher and higher. And the stained glass, one side, all basically primary colors, moving from blues to yellows to reds. it was absolutely glorious. I was dumbfounded and still sort of marvel at the photographs and couldn't be happier with that visit. And there you can see it.
Are they still building on it, or was it in any kind of repair or anything like that?
So got it. When he took it over, he, as the architect, he knew that the project would outlast his life. And they are still building it. It's still under construction, and they're still following closely a lot of Gaudí's original plans. When you're inside, you wouldn't be able to tell that it's still under construction. But on the outside, they're basically still building four very tall spires that are each going to have a symbol for each of the Gospels on each of them that will light up from within. So it is a feat. As James is going through, you can see a little bit of the video here.
Any idea when do they have a projected finishing date?
Yeah, I seem to recall it was about 15 years or so. I mean, it's still over a decade before it's going to be finished.
Oh, wow. But that's still, I mean, you know, when it comes to the magnitude of what that thing is, you know, to only have to wait another 15 years, I'm down, man. You know, that means I'm going to be, 65 years old, 66 years old. But I cannot wait to see that thing when it's finished.
Yeah, I wonder how realistic that date is, because right? Even Gaudí said, you know, it's a symbol of Spain. It's a symbol of Barcelona, and it should never be finished building, as though you should always be working on it. Like anything,
always be in repair. Anything that is any, like even a fraction of that size is always going to be having to have something repaired or maintained or whatever. But yeah, something that size is always going to be in repair. But yeah, I mean, that's awesome to think that they're going to be building on it probably continuously.
Yeah, it is pretty special. And I had never been to Barcelona in general, but I found it to be just an amazing city. So
loved
it.
What about the food? I mean, I'm always talking about the food. So, I mean, I found Barcelona food, the tapas, you know, just like, it's so good. You know, you just drink red wine and then you just eat these like little snacks that are like, you know, I call it like Spanish dim sum, you know, basically, and you just eat it, and it's so delicious, man. What did you try?
Spanish dim sum?
Well, yeah. No, but you're right. I mean, the tapas is great, because you go to, you know, a cafe or a bar, and they lay them all out, and you take, you know, one or two or three or five and take them back to your table, and they're all so delicious, whether it's the hams or the different types of meats, the desserts, obviously all the bread.
You tried the jamon ibérico.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what that is, Teachr? Did you try it, basically?
What did you call it?
It's kind of like Spanish prosciutto, basically. It's called jamon ibérico. So jamon is kind of like a special, it's just ham, basically, right? But jamon ibérico, basically, are these pigs that live on Ibiza that just eat, like, black walnuts for life, and then they make them into, like, the jamon, you know, or something like that, man. So it's just, you know, melt in your mouth like paper thin slices of you know, my mouth is salivating right now as we talk about it, man.
So good. And there's
I don't remember having that there. What I do remember discovering when I was there, which was actually back in 1992. I was there in 1992, doing some catalog photo modeling, fashion modeling at the time, and got there right when the Olympics had just finished, and they had the Para Olympics going on.
Hmm.
And the place where I was staying, I could actually walk to where they were having the events.
Mm-hmm.
And so I actually walked down this one day. I remember watching ping pong. These handicapped guys playing ping pong, okay? Hmm. Like, one guy had, like, only, I think, half a leg, and I think the other guy was in a wheelchair. And I used to be pretty good at ping pong. We had a ping pong table at my house when I was growing up and everything. And so even still this day, I'll kick both your asses. but these guys were, you know, Paralympic guy, and they could have wiped my ass all over the place. They were amazing. Mm. I remember sitting there just going, holy cow. Like, you know, right before they got started playing, I'm thinking, okay, how competitive is this game gonna be? You know, like, and then I'm going, holy shit, I gotta watch this until it ends, man, because this is a fucking nail biter, man. You know, but so that's when I was there, and so the La Sagra de Familia, mm-hmm. was nowhere near, you know, some of the towers, they were starting to build the towers and everything, mm-hmm. but I only saw it from a distance. At that time, I was too young to, I saw some of the Gaudi buildings and stuff like that, but I was a little bit more involved in partying and chasing girls than the arts at that time, you know, as a model. I mean, give me a break. So it was some different focus going on at the time. But I look forward to going back. That is one of my favorite places in the world. And plus you could take a train to Seaches. Did you go to Seaches?
No.
It's a little beach town that is, I'd say probably about maybe 40, 45 minute train ride. Okay. Outside of Barcelona, and that was where I went to the first topless beach that I ever went to in my life.
Hey, let me ask you real quick, at the Sagrada Familia, a lot of people don't know there's so many, like Teachr said, it's just like there's a beach there, you know what I mean? There's like, it's just the dynamic of the city, it's like so crazy to me, you know. Yeah. Which, did you get to experience all that, or I saw you went to a different art gallery called Picasso, right?
Yeah, Juan Miró, that's his foundation. Yeah, and I went to the Picasso Museum as well. So yeah, wow. I mean the city's built up on each other, and so I'm sure people just live in their little square of the city, and the beach is really nice there, and there's lots of architectural highlights on the beach too. I mean, they have a Frank Gehry sculpture on one of the buildings, one of those fish. He did the downtown LA concert hall. I think you're right. I think any sort of major metropolitan city, people don't know how rich the arts are, but anytime I go somewhere, you know, that's, I hunt it out and I want to see everything. It's just part of it. I can't leave without seeing it all.
That's wonderful. You know, what are the things that you take away from Barcelona? I mean, in terms of the people, did you get to talk to anybody in the arts there, or, you know, just anybody on the street, basically?
Yeah, I was surprised that the museums weren't as busy, which, I was told that you had to reserve tickets way in advance because they sold out and whatnot, but you know, they're relatively free, but I think that had something to do with a lot of the issues that were looming in the air around Italy and France and about the coronavirus and what was happening.
Yeah.
And even in Spain, it was in Madrid at that time. But you know, they're very proud. They're especially in Barcelona, they're very proud of their culture, their history, and who they are as Catalonians, and see themselves as quite distinct from the rest of the folks in Spain. And so in talking with folks who are not from Barcelona, they can definitely feel that. They don't feel as though they're part of that culture. They always feel like outsiders. And so there's some distinctions there. And so
they actually speak a different language, right? They're actually Catalonians, right?
That's so right. That's exactly
yeah,
right.
They actually, you know, have a different flag. And I always find that strange. It's like, mm-hmm. The U.S. media, we love to talk about certain areas that want independence, and right. then we love to not talk about certain areas, like in Spain. That
when I was there, they were actually protesting and striking in the streets. They were going crazy.
Mm-hmm.
It would start with a soccer game, and then I remember I was staying in this hostel, like a little hotel. And my tiny little balcony that I had, I could look down the little side street, and we were right along the Ramblas. And holy cow, man, there were people running up and down the alley, cops chasing them in cars up and down these alleys, and then people throwing Molotov cocktails
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God.
Fire all over the place. Now, yeah. This is one thing that blew my mind, okay? I remember seeing this one night. I had, I was able to find some hash over there. And so I just would, at the end of the day, when I was tired of doing everything, I'd just hole up in my room and I could sit on my bed. I could touch my sink. I could touch the door to the room and I could touch the window. This is how tiny the room was.
It's a closet.
There, I smoked a little hash and I stuck my head out the window. My little balcony was about a foot and a half out and about maybe 30 inches wide. And I looked down and just remember seeing all this fire and trash and people chasing and cops chasing people and stuff like that. And then thinking, man, that's going to look like, you know, the apocalypse tomorrow morning, man. I'm going to go to bed and get up and I'm going to go check this out in the morning, right? Dude, it was spick and span in the morning. Wow. It was tight. It was all cleaned up. It looked like nothing even happened.
Wow.
Keep that area really clean, that main street, Las Ramblas, what you're talking about, right?
I mean, don't get me wrong, the hash was good, but it wasn't that good. Dude, I saw, like, the amount of fire, like, I remember fires, I could see a fire down the street onto the Ramblas, where there was, like, a big pile of something, and there was a fire right there, and people throwing stuff on it and everything, cars zooming by, cops chasing people and stuff. You know, and I'm thinking,
Teach.
Well, I better not call my parents and tell them about this, man. They're going to be like, dumb home, oh my God.
Yeah, you know? That sounds scary. But even now, I mean, there's graffiti all over the city.
I was just about to ask you.
Everywhere. You can't go on any block and it's not full of graffiti. And there's lots of symbols for revolution. So it looks like the, you know, the ribbon that we do for fallen veterans or fallen military folks, they have a similar symbol for the revolution. So it's interesting to see that stuff everywhere you go. So while Teachr saw like physical things happening, you see it in the evidence in the writing on the streets. So I could totally see how that would happen.
That was not like that when I was there. I don't remember seeing any kind of, when you're saying graffiti, are you talking about like throwies?
Yeah, I'm talking tags. Yeah, right.
Tags and throwies, okay, yeah.
In Spain, actually, I feel like they definitely do limit some of the information you can search on the internet too, because if you want to go in there and look up some, I forgot the name of the dictator that was involved in Spain, but it's actually quite hard to find anyways, let me look that up. But like I said, I think that there's a lot of street art going on in Barcelona as well too. You know, a lot of people were connected with them too, street art BCN, basically, if you want to check them out. Okay. Take a look. But yeah, let me look that up. But yeah, people don't really talk about Catalonia wanting to be an independence basically in American media at all. You know, I think that's most Americans don't realize that, you know, Madrid is a completely separate state than Barcelona.
Yep, exactly.
Absolutely.
And they do have some nice curated areas for street art and graffiti, both, that as you walk around the city. So they do seem to embrace it in parts, but yeah, the throw-ups and the tags are something, and even the stickers on everything. There's stickers on everything,
wow.
Which is really wonderful. I love it. I love seeing it, but it's so strange, like every single block.
It's not the main street that they keep beautiful, like Teach said though, right?
Yeah, if you're going into the main park where they had, you know, the World's Fair, you know, and all those buildings, they're really right. Nice. But yeah, everything else. Yeah.
Yeah, who I was talking about was Franco, basically, too. I was in Spain, and I was just trying to look up some information, just kind of read up on the history. And it was interesting. It was hard to find a lot of stuff while I was there, you know. And people don't talk about that ever, basically.
Well, they can't, because they can't find any info.
That's true, you know.
It's repressed. Their information is repressed over there.
Yeah, definitely. And I just think it's quite interesting. You know, we love to talk about certain areas that want independence in our American media. While, you know, Catalonia, for the longest time, these guys are like, well, hey, we're half French. You know, we have better wine and we don't kill.
It's not Barcelona, it's Barcelona. TH, Barcelona.
It goes back so far. Gaudí was that way too. He was part of clubs and architectural societies that were basically celebrating the history and culture of Catalonia. You know?
Definitely. And you know what? One of the things that, I mean, it's tragic how he died, but he was actually on mushrooms when he died. Is that
true? I didn't know that. I had no idea. Well, they didn't mention that in his book.
Doesn't surprise me. I mean, dude, you look at his stuff and that's, you know.
Well,
this is what I heard. Yeah, I mean, if you look at his stuff, it's definitely very psychedelic, right? And then From the tour guy I had, basically he was, you know, on one of his strolls one day and basically on mushrooms, and then he got hit by one of the trains actually there, and that's how he
died. I do know he got hit by the train. I didn't know he was a very strict Catholic though. I mean, he restricted his diet. He would dip his lettuce leaves in milk. And so he was very sort of thin and weak and frail. Mm. So if he did do anything like that, it would have been natural, you know, it wouldn't have been. So I don't know. I couldn't comment. I don't know enough about it, but
the mushrooms are natural, right?
he was eccentric and he was weird. He was definitely strange.
Oh, you know what? That's right. That's where that happened. Oh my gosh. Okay. I just remembered an experience I had when I was in Barcelona. At that time, like I said, I was doing some modeling. And one of the things that they would do is they would invite a bunch of models to one of the dance clubs, one of the big dance clubs.
Yeah.
And so you would get in for free. You wouldn't have to wait in line or anything like that. And you drink for free. And all you do is just hang out. So I'm hanging out in this club and I meet this girl, right? Hot looking girl. Don't even, you know, it's just looking at each other type of thing, like throughout the night, right? And then right towards the end of the night, you know, just found, oh my gosh, I'm standing right next to her at the bar, right? And finally worked the courage up to say hi, you know, because in my mind, I'd already worked this out as amazing, you know, whatever. And when she said hi back, the voice was deeper than mine.
Are you flashing back to some horror stories from Barcelona that you want to share with the therapist?
No, it's like the crying game. You know, this is right around that time where, like, you know, I looked down and the next thing I saw was hand. Nice. Yeah, that's some Gaudí right there.
Yeah, I'm waiting for you to tell you your transgender story so we can talk about if it's possible. No, what I was reading, Jim, is that... you know, because this
great,
is
like, great segue. Great segue.
Did you go to the park and did you see some of these other designs, like this one right here? Basically, did you go to that park? I don't know. I just thought it was like really, really psychedelic. A lot of his designs, you know.
Definitely. Well, the mosaic where it's cut and it looks like broken stone or glass.
Yeah.
Like when he was a young kid, he was very interested in sort of rebuilding one of the local churches when he was like just a teenager. So this idea of taking rubble and trying to repair is something he was always interested in. So I love seeing that, those mosaic designs in so many of his things. But yeah, the park is, Park Gui is pretty beautiful. It's a nice uphill run.
Well, how's the weather? Was it nice? Because when I went, it was super hot and I was just like, it gets real hot in Spain, you know, so.
Yeah, we had perfect weather. It was in the 60s and 70s the whole time. Sun was shining, no rain. So photos were great and it was great for sightseeing. Absolutely.
Wonderful.
Tell you what, one of the things that I love about what you were just talking about, the broken up tiles and pieces that were put together is that stuff keeps its color.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It doesn't get baked out in the sun or anything like that. And that's why these pieces just stay so vivid and amazing looking for so long.
Yeah.
It's one of the things that I absolutely loved about that place.
Yeah. And that park, it has this mix of like a Candyland aesthetic.
Yes.
Yeah, they have those wonderful, but then there has like this Lord of the Rings in this image right here. You can see like these like stone-like structures that it's like multiple personalities did it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think he did mushrooms. That's just my personal opinion.
Well, those pictures you were pointing out with the building,
yeah, you know,
like I said, exactly like a mushroom.
But, yeah. But what I'm just saying is, you know, this guy definitely, I mean, actually I Googled it and there's not that much like raw data on the mushroom thing. So I'm happy that, you know, you told me, so I stopped spreading that. Cause I don't know, anything that's been in Barcelona, I tell them that Gaudí did mushrooms and I show them that picture. So, you know,
it seems based on his history, it'd seem hard to believe, but yeah, you never know.
You never know, though. It is a natural thing, you know what I mean? And Catholicism was quite different than, you know what I mean? There's sacraments and you know, all these things. So
you never know, you know what I mean? But
that's true.
But yeah, no, Jim, you know, it's pretty much come up on an hour, man. And, you know, I just want to thank you again for always coming on the show and entertaining us, man, and giving some credibility to our show.
I love you guys. I'm always happy to talk and love hearing what you guys are up to. And I appreciate you being supportive. Thanks for coming out to the show. Thanks for being part of it, Teach. You know, I've always been a fan of your work. So thank you both for being part of it. I really appreciate it.
And now you know more stories about Teach now too, and personal stories, you know? I mean, when one day when you're talking about his art in Barcelona, you can say that, hey, when this artist was in Barcelona,
when he was a model.
Crying game.
When he was a model. I know this guy, he was a model.
Actually, he was more than a model. He was a Chippendales guy, you know what I mean?
Oh boy. Yeah, that's for another time.
Hey, Jim, I want to actually, you know what? It would be cool to ask you to help us get some high-profile guests sometimes. You know what I mean? I think it would be, well, after this whole thing blows over, I mean, maybe one day we can sit down and, you know, maybe we
can. Well, Doug, now that we can do the Zoom, I mean, come on. Anyone that turns us down to just sit at home and in front of their computer and do it on the Zoom, I mean, you know, screw these guys.
Yeah, no, I don't want to. But the thing is, I want to talk to these people in person, Teach. You know what I mean? Yeah, it'd be cool.
Hey, listen, okay, I'd just like to make one point when it comes to this, all right? Dave Navarro, okay? Legendary rock and roll guitarist.
Upcoming, okay? Street art.
Showed up out in City of Industry, like you did, Jim.
Yeah.
Showed up 45 minutes early.
Well, there you go.
He was there before I was there. I'm early. I get there early. Every time I get there early, I make sure I'm early. He was there before I – he was texting me going, hey, man, where should I wait? I'm like, oh, my God, dude, you're already there? So my point is, if Dave Navarro can drive way out to City of Industry for an hour interview, then come on. Anybody can sit on a computer and do this.
That's true.
Well, I mean, you know what, man? Dave Navarro, he's such a generous guy, man. Shout out to him. What do you – I mean, are you enjoying –
Oh, but you know what? We have to mention, though, if we mention Dave Navarro, is phasing out of being Dave Navarro. He's becoming Life After Death Street. And, dude, let me just tell you, he is prolific. And he is doing collaborations with a ton of different artists. And it's just helping him to grow. And, I mean, he's very fast becoming, you know, a very well-respected force in the streets, man.
That's cool.
Jim, are you enjoying his work? Have you seen some of his stuff going up? Just curious. I'm going to put you on the spot.
I've seen him pop up in other people's feeds. So I don't know Dave. I like Stephen Levy. I know he's done some stuff with him. So I don't know enough about his
everyone, work. Man. Jeez.
Yeah, that guy is everywhere. I know. He sent me a text last night. He said he's the nicest guy, too. But I see Dave pop up in other people's feeds and collaborating with folks, but I don't know enough about his work in general. I just know.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying his stuff. If you guys
check out Life After Death Street.
Or check out episode 22 of this podcast, actually. We had him on and talked to us for an hour. Anyways, guys, so thank you so much. We always appreciate you, Jim, for coming on. And, you know, where can we find you, man? Is there anything you want to promote? I mean, aside
from... How can people get your books that we were talking about earlier?
Well, I'm really excited right now because the new biography on Robbie Conal just published. And so it just came out. So... when this all blows over, we're going to have an LA Live Talks with me, Shepard, and Robbie, and which will be a really big event. I'll let you know. It was scheduled for this summer, but we'll probably get it rescheduled. So once this thing blows over, we'll get some more hype and interest in that. But it's actually available now. Some folks who pre-ordered just got it in the mail this week, and I just got some copies today. So it looks so good. So I'm so happy with it.
It's like four dads to our collection, man. The wife's ready to scope too.
Yeah, it has every poster from his career. So starting with one he did before even Reagan that he did in the basement of his studio was an occult gun factory on the East Coast. And, you know, he made a poster there with some college kids. And then every poster since then is in the books. Plus, it tells his whole life story, which is, his story is crazy. I mean, I know, you get to live through someone's life, and I've lived through his life now for a few years, and it's pretty special. So I'm looking forward to that, and that's probably the biggest thing I'm promoting at the moment.
Awesome. Dude, I definitely going to be adding it to my collection.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
You know, we're a bunch of dummies, but we would love to do our podcast at your next talk when, Shepard Fairey and all those guys are there too. And,
you see how easy we are. You just throw us outside, whatever. We're fine wherever, right? Yeah,
I'll just set my computer on the stage right there.
Exactly. You know, we were actually security that night. We were like, oh, you can't come through here, you know.
You guys were blocking a whole side of the museum, so I appreciate that.
Yeah. Well, Jim, anyways, so I just wanted, we're taking up so much of your time, but we wanted to thank you for zooming in, and we appreciate you. And at the end of the day, man, we'd love for you to come on again and just kind of share whatever you're promoting.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Always. Man. I'm always happy to, and always happy to help as well.
We got to send you some more stickers too. You see that canvas in the back? Teachr kind of did some stickers of those. So we're going to have a sticker meetup. Hopefully you can come up too.
That'd be awesome.
Get out of this mess, you know what I mean?
I saw him stenciling that right before the museum show opened.
Yeah,
that's right.
We made a bunch of little stickers, and hopefully people will go out and bomb them and keep people aware of our show, you know what I mean?
Cool.
We charge for littering.
Is that with the mustaches on them and everything?
Yeah, no, that was actually my idea, actually. You know, it was like nice right there, just how it was. And I was like, you know what? I hate my face, actually. Just put a mustache on it, please. And then,
love it.
Pop, you know what I mean? And then Teachr went and did, he's like, I'm going to do myself too, you know what I mean? So it ended up being like a nice collaboration from our minds, you know.
Very cool. That's awesome. I love it.
We'll give you some next time to see it too. All right?
Awesome.
Awesome. Take
good
care.
To help you and yours and all those people around you stay safe and smart and wash your hands.
Yep, absolutely. To you as well. Stay safe and healthy, and everyone out there, please do as well.
Awesome. Peace, guys.
Thanks, brother.
All right. See you guys. Bye.
And in the love you take is equal.